In this video, we're going to find the partial fraction decomposition of the rational function shown here. So whenever we're asked to find the partial fraction decomposition of a rational function, the first thing we always want to check is to make sure that that rational function is proper. And for a rational function to be proper, the degree of the denominator needs to be greater than the degree of the numerator. And that's the case here. So this rational function is proper. We can only use the process of partial fraction decomposition on proper rational functions, which is why it's always so important to check. If it's improper, then you can begin by using long division to rewrite the rational function. But in any case, for this rational function, we're fine to go ahead and do partial fractions. So the first thing we want to do is we want to check to see if the top can be factored, and then we also want to factor the denominator as well. So in my case, on the top, I have x cubed minus 5x squared minus x minus 3. You can try to factor that. It does not factor in this case. So then our next step is to look at factoring the denominator. Now, the denominator is a special form, which hopefully you recognize, as something called the difference of squares. So a difference of squares has the form a squared minus b squared, and it factors into a plus b times a minus b. So in my case then, I have x to the fourth minus 1. That's going to factor into x squared plus 1 times x squared minus 1. But I always want to factor completely. That means factor as much as I can. So now I want to examine each of these factors to see if any of those can be factored. Now, x squared plus 1 is irreducible, or maybe you could even say prime. That cannot be factored any further because it's a sum of squares. But x squared minus 1 is another difference of squares, so I can factor that further. So I'm going to keep my x squared plus 1, but x squared minus 1 becomes x plus 1 times x minus 1. So we're completely factored. And now that we're at this point, we can verify that there's nothing that's going to cancel out. So our rational function is reduced as much as possible. So then we're going to go ahead and proceed with partial fractions. So let's notice what type of factors we have in the denominator here. So I have an x squared plus 1, and we just said that's an irreducible quadratic, meaning that we can't factor it any further. And both x plus 1 and x minus 1 are simple linear factors. So that tells me about the form of my partial fraction decomposition. So let's first concentrate on the term that's going to go along with this irreducible quadratic factor. So I'm going to have an x squared plus 1 in the denominator. Now, for irreducible quadratic factors, our numerator is more than just a constant. It's actually a linear expression. So on the top here, I'm going to have an expression ax plus b, where a and b are unknown constants that I'm going to have to solve for in a moment. So that's it for the irreducible quadratic factor. If this was repeated, for example, if it was x squared plus 1 quantity squared, then I'd have another similar term to go along with it. But since it's simple, or it's just raised to the first power, we're just going to have this single term. So the next, I'm going to need a term for each of these linear factors. Once again, each of these are simple, right? Each of these are simple linear factors appearing only to the first power. So I'm just going to have one term for each of them. So a term with an x plus 1 in the denominator. And since that's a linear factor on the bottom, I'm just going to have a constant on the top. We can call it c. And then I'm going to have a term for x minus 1 as well. We'll call that associated constant d. So this is the form of my partial fraction decomposition. And my next step is going to be to solve for these unknown constants a, b, c, and d. To begin that process, I need to multiply both sides of this expression by the common denominator, or which is this expression x squared plus 1, x plus 1, x minus 1. I'm going to multiply both sides of the expression by that. And the purpose of this is just to get rid of all my denominators. So then on the left-hand side, I'm just left with x cubed minus 5x squared minus x minus 3 equals. And then on the right-hand side, I want to think about distributing this expression here and then reducing as appropriate. So if I do that, it looks like I should be left with ax plus b times x plus 1 times x minus 1 plus c times x squared plus 1 times x minus 1 plus d times x squared plus 1 times x plus 1. Now that we're here, our goal is to solve for a, b, c, and d. This is going to be a little complicated because there's so many coefficients. Now remember, we've kind of learned two main ways to go about solving for the coefficients. The first way we learned is to equate powers of x. So to do that, on the right-hand side here, what I would do is I would expand everything, and then I'd group powers of x, x squareds, x cubes, x's, and constant terms, and then I would equate the coefficients on either side of the equal sign. If you do that, you're going to end up with a system of four equations with four unknowns, and you solve that system of equations. The other way we learned is called the convenient values method, and that's where I try to pick some convenient values of x to plug in hopes that some of my constants or some of my coefficients will disappear and I'll be able to solve for the others. Now, in more complicated expressions like this, sometimes you'll have to use a combination of those methods to solve for all your constants. So let's start by using the convenient values method, since that method is so easy, and see if we can solve for any of our coefficients using that. And then if there are any left over, we can try to use another method as needed. Okay, so looking at this, it looks like probably some convenient values are going to be x equals 1 and x equals negative 1. It looks like that'll get some things to go away. So I'm going to start by letting x equals 1. If I do that, I'm going to plug 1 in for x everywhere, and I will get the following expression. And I can work on cleaning this up a little bit. Negative 8 equals 4d is what I'm left with in the very end. So then that tells me that d equals negative 2. So then let's try the same process with another convenient value. We'll let x equal negative 1. So a lot of stuff on the right-hand side is going to go away, right? I see that I have a factor of 0 here and a factor of 0 here as well. So if I reduce, I get the following. I end up with negative 8 equals negative 4c, which tells me then that c equals positive 2. So I've pretty much reached the end of what I'm able to do with the convenient values method. I'm not going to be able to isolate this ax plus b using this method. So to proceed, let's actually go ahead and substitute d and c back into this expression to simplify things a little bit. Now from here, I'm going to use the method of equating like powers of x, and hopefully it'll be a little bit easier for us since we'll only have a system of two unknowns instead of four like we would have had before. Now to do this is going to be a little tedious, and I'm not going to show you every step for the sake of time, but all I'm going to do is I'm going to completely expand this right hand side by foiling, distributing, and then I'm going to combine like terms. So if we go through all that work, we end up at this point. And if you need to pause the video and look at those steps, feel free to do that. So now what I can do is, once again, I'm interested in solving for a and for b, and I'm going to do that by equating like powers of x. So let's start by looking at a. So I see that I have this ax cubed. Now for this relationship to be true, this equality here, this has to be true for all x's, which means that the coefficient of the x cubed on the left and the right side need to be equivalent. So on the right-hand side, the coefficient of x cubed is a, and on the left-hand side, the coefficient is 1. So then I simply say that I must know that A equals 1. And that's that for that method. Now you'll also see that I have an A down here as well in front of this X. And I can match that up with the left-hand side, and you'll see that I get the same result. So that can happen. You can get the same result from looking at different powers of X here. So then let's do the same thing with the B's. I can look at the coefficient of X squared here. Okay, and I see that I have a coefficient of B minus 4. And my coefficient of X squared on the left is negative 5, so I know that I must have B minus 4 equals negative 5, which gives me then that B equals negative 1. So now I have all my coefficients solved for, so I'm ready to write down my final answer. So this is what we came from originally. We had this rational function here, and this was our form of our partial fraction decomposition. So now I just plug in the coefficients I found. So A was 1 and B was negative 1, so that's going to give me an 1x, or just x, minus 1 on the top of that first fraction over x squared plus 1, plus c, which is 2, over x plus 1, plus d, which is negative 2. So I'm going to write minus 2 over x minus 1. And this is our partial fraction decomposition.